unfortunately, Adrian Jones, the chair, is not able to be here, so as vice chair, I'll chair the meeting. So can I welcome everybody to Employment and Appointments Committee. Item number one is members' code of conduct, declaration of interest. Do any members wish to declare any interests? Please say now. No? Okay. Minutes, to approve the minutes from the meetings held on the 27th of June, 10th of October and 18th of December 2017. Can we approve those minutes?
Agreed.
Agreed? Okay, thank you. And then we've got item three is employment and appointments panel minutes, pages 17, 32. These are various appointments. Can we approve those minutes?
Agreed.
Okay. Okay, and then item four is a referral from Audit and Risk Management Committee on Absence Management. So the Audit and Risk Management Committee, at its meeting on the 21st of November last year, referred to this committee together with the Attendance Management Action Plan. So is that you, Tony, to speak to us?
Okay, Chair.
Cool. Thank you. Okay.
The report sets out a detailed study into the level of absence in the council and how absence is being managed and monitored, and there's a particular focus on stress and mental health related absence. This came under discussion at Audit Risk Management in November in response to an agenda item on attendance management, and the committee resolved that the attendance management action plan be noted and referred to the Employment and Appointments Committee for further consideration, and that the Chief Executive be requested to attend the next meeting of the Employment and Appointments Committee to provide further updates on matters regarding the Council's approach to stress and absence management. Attached to the report is a quite a detailed study of absence within the Council, so I won't go through every single aspect of that, but we'll just pick out some of the key areas and points and obviously about any questions that the committee may have. So the report sets out some background in terms of the context of the council, in terms of workforce numbers and the number of posts that we have and how that's changed over the last number of years. And we also move on to compare that to how that compares with neighbouring authorities. It does also point out within the report that actually we're quite different in our models of delivery to a number of our neighbours, so there's some caution to be exercised in exactly how we can compare various aspects of sickness absence. But it does show that World Council overall is projected to lose around 10.74 days absence in this financial year, which is around the third highest of Merseyside local authorities. Just as we move through the pack into page 38 of your bundle, page 39, we start to some breakdowns of sickness type. And it explains that mental health problems is the third highest cause of absence within the council, but is the highest number of days lost. So the highest number, in terms of causes, it's abdominal, which is kind of tummy bugs, as well as ear, nose and throat, which is kind of coughs and colds, which is expected around short-term absence, with stress and mental health being the third biggest reason. The number of days that are lost due to mental health related conditions has seen an overall increase in 2010-11, and indicates that that would come in around 4.7 days per FTE. And if this projection is correct, then it will be the highest figure for the period in this measure. So further breakdown of detailed breakdown of mental health conditions in the world, we've looked at the number of staff over the last 7 or 8 years with mental health related absence. That's been really consistent at around about 10%, and that's shown in on page 40 in your bundle, table 2. As I mentioned earlier, the table 3 on page 41 sets out that mental health is the cause of the most days absence, with the average days lost for a mental health absence being 33 days, which is really way in excess of the next one, which is musculoskeletal and other medical procedures. effort, which the report also says to state that it can be quite difficult to look back over such a period of time, 7 or 8 years with the movement between directorates in the council. Brought in just some commentary on that. As of 13 November 2017, anxiety, stress and depression has exhausted 2.46 days lost to FTE, as opposed to the wider mental health related conditions being responsible for 7.12 days. Moving on in terms of the organisational action in relation to staff absence, we've done some comparative work with the CIPD survey for 2016, which is the last one available, to look at the council's approach to managing both short-term absence, long-term absence, and specifically around mental health. And that shows that broadly the methods that the council are employing are very consistent with how other organisations across a range of different sectors are also trying to address this issue. We move on in the report to set out some more detail about what the council is doing in terms of our targeted approach to this, to absence and also to mental health. We developed a new suite of absence reporting, which is available to managers, DMTs and SLT, which shows a wide range of different metrics. And we're taking some targeted action in a number of areas, including some hotspot areas that we've identified within the workforce, and also for those longer term cases of more 60 days or more. There was another report in 2017 which indicated some evidence of under-reporting of absence. In response to this, we've rolled out some training for managers in ensuring that they are clear on their responsibilities and also the technical skills required to input absence into our HR system. And we're doing some specific work with Wirral Mine around stress management and equipping our managers and employees with the skills required to hopefully identify stress and mental health issues early. And that's part of a wider approach. Earlier this year we launched our workplace wellbeing strategy. It sets out a number of different initiatives over the course of next year, themes through the year, working with public health colleagues as well, to encourage staff and across the workforce to look after themselves in terms of their own health and wellbeing, to signpost them through different mechanisms to support them if they are struggling in work. And this is alongside our existing processes and procedures in place whereby if somebody is off sick, it's a first aid referral to occupational health. All our employees have access to the Employee Assistance Programme, the EAP, which gives instant access to counselling, up to 6 sessions of counselling, and there is specialist counselling also available, and that can be face to face or on the telephone. So, finally, we touch upon the issue of management accountability and how we're monitoring and tracking absence management within the council. As I mentioned earlier, new management reports have been developed for senior managers to monitor compliance by their reports with the absence policy that has been rolled out. HR business partners are attending DMTs and SLTs to discuss absence and the issues of concern with service managers. All line managers are required to discuss absence levels as part of the performance management process. And as I touched upon earlier, internal audit routine the audit to compliance against policy and compliance. All managers have access to desktop information with detailed absence information for their teams and individuals. So I've gone through that report quite quickly, it is quite detailed. The conclusion within the report is that mental health related absence is the third highest known reason for staff absence. 18% of all workplace absence is related to mental health issues, with approximately 10% of the workforce having been absent from work for a mental health related absence. This is a priority area for us, and as I've set out, there's a range of initiatives in place, including a focus on mental health support and signposting employees to help if they feel they need it. So that concludes the report.
Okay, thanks so much for that. Okay, I'll open it up to comments, questions, whatever.
Yeah, thanks very much, Tony. You may well have sent, I missed it. I see that in the places where people are suffering from stress and mental health related disorder, that you give them support of an occupational health referral. How quickly does that referral happen? And following that referral, would it be considered automatic referral on to some sort of counselling service? And saying that really because if we're going through the GP route, there's a 12-month wait for any kind of fairly basic support. So that is really rules out from an emergency point of view, isn't it? So could you just talk through that?
Yes, the council policy is that there's a day one referral for anybody who contacts us and doesn't come into work due to a mental health related condition. The turnaround time to actually get them to triage is quite quickly, certainly within a week, 5 working days. And from that, they have access to a whole range of different specialist mental health nurses. If the individual. Yeah, I mean, from that point of view, obviously we can set out the range of options that are available. If they are reticent about going to through the occupational health route, there is the confidential route through the EAP, which we can signpost them through, which some people prefer, which is anonymised. They don't have to, they don't get a report back about the individual's condition, and the line managers know, so some people prefer that route. And as I said earlier, they can have up to 6 sessions of counselling through that route. But we can also extend it where there's a case made. So there's a range of different ways that we can help. But in answer to your question, it certainly would be quicker than a GP referral. We're able to counsel.
How can it be affected, it seems, from the figures?
I think it's difficult to say given the range of different mental health conditions that. That we may be dealing with and the causes and the reasons. So in terms of some of the work we've done in producing this report, mental health charity Mind, who are doing some work with us, have said that 1 in 4 people will experience a mental health problem in the course of a year, and 1 in 3 GP referrals currently have a mental health component. So in terms of the workforce, from our evidence, I said earlier that it's the third highest cause of absence. But we also know it's a mix of home, work, and possibly a combination of both. The a multitude of.
Before you do this, you probably have said it in the report. What's the average length of sickness for someone who's comes from that?
33 days. Yeah, so it's almost always long term when somebody does go off sick. So obviously, part of the strategy that we want to put in place is to. Catch them before, if you like, in terms of putting those supports in place and making sure that they've got that access. Okay, listen.
Thank you. Going on from what Laurie was asking, really, and again, it's probably been a question you've touched on, is about the help that you're getting from Mind.
Yeah.
So, I mean, clearly, if people are in work and they're stressed, it's completely different than if they're in work with a bad back. More often than not, say, you know, that's killing me or your head or this or that. But for somebody to come forward and say to even a colleague that I'm under line manager that they're suffering with stress is probably one of the biggest hurdles that you could imagine, really. And particularly, you know, at a time when, you know, yes, the organisation is shrinking, you know, maybe really reticent to do that. So I'd be interested, really, just for you to expand a little bit on the work that we're trying to do so that managers actually spot that somebody is obviously, you know, suffering from stress, and what we're doing to make those individuals feel comfortable to actually either go to a line manager or go to a colleague of, you know, this the same level as that. Funny enough, I've been over at Fire Authority today, and it was a meeting of all the different, it wasn't a public meeting, we were meeting with staff and we were talking about how they're handling it in the fire service. And they've been using a program called Mental Health First Aid. You're probably aware of it, if you're not, maybe you could like to perhaps to talk to the Occupational Health Department over in Fire. And as I was driving over there this morning on the radio, they had a teacher on, who was actually a teacher of the year, which is stupid, this really, but she was talking about you know, how the things that she'd done with colleagues in school, and they talked about the use of mindfulness, which seems to be one of, you know, the biggest But are we looking at that sort of strategies as well?
Yes.
So first of all, Tottenham managers are being trained to spot difficulties and how comfortable you think, you know, from the HR department, people are actually coming forward and saying that they are having problems and they're returning to work.
Okay, yeah, so I think in terms of the training that they're doing for us, that saying that I'm managing the first instance, well, best man will be on that. And the session overview is to increase knowledge and understanding of mental health and well-being, so the managers to be able to recognise the signs of symptoms of stress and mental health problems, to understand how mental health affects people, to have some confidence in supporting mental health and well-being within the workplace, to access and be able to signpost people who work within their teams to resources, and to promote positive mental health and well-being in the workplace. So the session overview from Mind, we've gone into that now. It started about September and we're working out with managers. And there's been a lot of, I think, outside of the council work around raising or dealing with the stigma of mental health and trying to make it that isn't taboo, it's okay to talk about. We don't have any direct evidence of that in terms of, you know, whether it's increased or decreased within the council, people do or don't feel less confident. Obviously, in terms of the EAP and the signpost, that does give that anonymous, absolutely confidential route for people to take. But certainly, I guess, from the figures that we see, for the wrong reasons, if you like, that people are more confident in saying this is what the issue is than perhaps they were in the past. And that's something that as an employer we support. So, you know, I think it's a very complex issue, as I'm sure the committee know, in terms of there's not one solution to this. And I think some of the approaches we've taken is to try and put as many different initiatives in place, because everybody's different, everyone's got different triggers and reasons why mental health may be an issue for them. Specifically around the question around the mindfulness, yes, it is something that we've got planned. We've got a calendar of events through the year and their theme through the different quarters. And it's encouraging people really to take some responsibility and ownership for their own health and well-being. And everything fits into that really, including volunteering and doing different things that perhaps give you a different perspective and widen the scope just from where, you know, work-life balance. The policies of flexible work that we have in place. Put some sessions on as well, you know, lunch times, and so there's some plans for that from mindfulness. I'm aware that mental health first aid is something that's been flagged to us as something that we should be looking at. And that's certainly something that we're happy to explore. So I think with the health and wellbeing strategy, there's a whole range of different things we're looking at. Everything from improving the internet resource for people to go and look at different articles around stress and mental health and well-being, to also encouraging people to take up Invigorate memberships. We've offered them an hour free from an induction away from work, to again promote our health and well-being, which hopefully would have an impact on mental health and well-being as well.
And the time scales for doing all this, we seem to be going to do an awful lot, but when you look at these figures, it looks as if
yeah, the training I alluded to is in place and has been rolled out. It started in September. Health and wellbeing strategy study that is now in place. We've had a number of events already. At the beginning of this year, there was a pledge, quite a number of senior managers and trade union colleagues and employees made pledges. And again, that was about promoting health and wellbeing. So a lot of the activities that I've described are underway. And maybe some time before we see how that impacts on our figures. And of course, the difficulty with mental health is you may not ever know if you've caught somebody from going off. So we do want to see a reduction in the numbers of people who are off circuit calls. But actually, in terms of the support that we've got in place, it's quite difficult, often to measure how successful that is.
Okay, Phil. Provide information about health care, and I did a contingent process at various times, which I hope to see.
hoping that we'll do that capacity, because of the numbers that we can see, the referral that Laura has to, and sometimes we're working through people, hopefully.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, it's just entered a new contract with a company called Pound Assist, who quite one of the big players within the occupational health field. And as part of that contract, they were obviously well aware of some statistics, what throughput is, what we would be looking for in terms of the service from them. So we've got no evidence of delays or concerns about their resources in delivering it. And actually, in the new contract, there's a lot more that we're doing with them in terms of the proactive support that they can offer to us in terms of coming into the workplace, hotspot in some areas such as children's social care, to come in and do blood pressure checks, and some of their care employee MOTs have all been put into the new spec. So there are some really kind of positive opportunities within the new contract that Pam will be able to deliver. In fact, they've been doing some roadshows this week in terms of selling and promoting the services to staff to raise awareness.
Okay, cheers.
Thank you for a couple of questions. Thanks, Tony, for the people. Just the first one, a very quick question. On table 7, there's a list of the common actions that are taken by CIPD members for the survey. I'm just wondering why we don't do staff surveys. I think that's probably a good opportunity for someone to anonymously flag any issues. And also in 4.6, we talk about hotspots and stress risk assessments. And I'm assuming that's done rightly. So we look at service areas and comes to a view whether or not those that it's a be a stressful situation. Can that be rolled out across the organisation, or is that very specific? You mentioned you've also a lot about through trained managers to spot stress. Who's looking after the managers? Because I think everyone can chip it down. We'll probably feel stressed in itself.
Okay, yeah, just happy to come back on those points. In terms of the survey, I did put across by that, just simply it's been a couple of years since we've done one. We've done lots of mini surveys, but we've not done an organisational wide one for a couple of years now. There is a plan to do that. We did do a survey within children's services as part of the children's workforce strategy, which informed the workplace wellbeing strategy as well, to look at what sources of support that staff would value, what the issues were. Actually, that's where the mindfulness and some of those sessions came from as well. Some more times walks and those kind of things. So we've done some surveys about doing an organisational wide one. The stress risk assessment, it takes a couple of forms really. There's one where people are still at work and they've identified that there's some stresses. We've got some trained members of our health and safety team who would support managers in undertaking that stress risk assessment. But equally, probably just as important is when people return to work after a period of sickness through stress or mental health, making sure that they don't go straight back into the same environment or the same issues that perhaps cause them to go off. So looking at that, making use of phase returns, but also stress risk assessments to try and ensure that don't repeat. And in terms of training for managers, I think it's obviously a good point. I think the real training that we're doing ostensibly is around managers also being able to manage themselves and recognise their own stress, so as well as spotting signs in others. Clearly managers need to be able to manage their own stress and recognise if they are struggling, and that's certainly something that we're online covering their session.
Okay, go ahead.
In the workplace I come from, we do a lot of mindfulness. It's encouraged, but it's also encouraged that people take the proper breaks. So a lot of time and effort is given to the environment that we work in, breakout areas, system, especially if someone's stepping up and someone's doing extra responsibilities. Do we actually monitor people who are stepping up? Do we monitor people are taking their proper official breaks? Is that monitored as such?
There's no stress on the monitoring rates, but as part of some of the work we've done earlier this year around the workplace wellbeing strategy, that's actually some of the things that we've flagged up and encouraged people to do in some of the promotion and some of the marketing of the workplace wellbeing that we've done. In fact, some of the pledges were along those lines as well about how to start to take a lunch break. And actually, I think it's some of those really simple things and day-to-day things that have an impact. So I think we're all, probably all guilty of putting back-to-back meetings and over lunchtime and all those things. And actually, it's really getting managers as the role models in this to make sure that staff do take breaks and are encouraged to manage the work-life balance. So we don't have any formal systems of knowing what that is in terms of breaks, but certainly it's been a feature of the initiatives that we've set out in. Encouraging people to manage their own health and wellbeing a lot better.
We've got a reading club. People are encouraged to just go and read for half an hour because we read for half an hour breaks the cycle of what we've been doing, just breaks it totally. So especially in case we're doing the type of things that we do there, just breaks that cycle. So maybe some thought needs to be done.
Across the way there, putting a new kind of room in for staff breakouts here as well, because recognised that we moved a lot of staff back into town over the last few years and developing the facility here. There was a lack of facilities for lunch, somewhere to go, and what that means is staff end up taking lunch at the desk and pick the phone up, or they don't actually need
to
switch
on.
So it's encouraging people to take a walk, to go out, to go and sit somewhere else and socialise and have a break from what they're doing. Goes a long way. I think it's only small, simple steps, but those kind of things that would impress
me. We've also got Councillor Friday. Councillor Friday is we have one of the Statesbury councillors there every Friday. So anybody who wants to go up and have a chat for 2 hours, there's a councillor there. To go and have your lunch, if you want to go and have a chat with the councillor in the room on Friday, which has proved to be very, very successful.
Okay, George. Yeah, just putting it on the background page on page 35, really awesome. Tells you the active workforce figure is now 2,725 full-time equivalents. And then the startling thing to me is the 10.73 days it works out, and it worked out for 4.4 million to the cost of the authority. I was just wondering, I remember a few years back, or two or three years back, there was a policy that was running through the GPs where they could actually send people with mental problems or anything like that to like invigilate for free. Yeah. And it was a thing which I think was a good thing. And I just wonder if there any, I mean, looking at the value and looking at that to the work of the workforce, is there anything better we can be doing ourselves to make that 10.7 come down to an acceptable level, like 6 or 7%?
Yeah, again, I mean, a lot of the initiatives that I've set out are obviously designed to try and reduce the levels of staff absence. I think that it's twofold, really. One is around putting support in place for people in work, making sure they don't go off as well as possible, we have a healthy workforce, as many initiatives and different ways to access services, in an easy way in front of them is definitely one part of the strategy. The second is if they do unfortunately go off, dealing with it quickly, getting support in place quickly. Now with the occupational health services we've got, we can do that. I think probably where we can look to develop is how creative those occupational health solutions are as well, in terms of not just about counselling, there's different ways you can encourage people in different ways that may enable to return to work sooner. Again, touch upon mindfulness, but also physical exercise, referring to our gym. So we have got some opportunities there, and I think that's something that we probably need to look at a little bit more. We've got a good range of services through the occupational health contract, but I think we can probably do a little bit more in some areas as well.
Okay, anybody else?
Phil?
What sort of posters and stuff I've seen when members turn their own computers on and see the internal stuff. This seems to be very helpful in terms of calming stuff. You know, this fright or flight thing, if I don't get it right, when people get more and more worked up, and the opportunities for people to sort of go, it's very important to me, hence to take entirely George's point about the investment in trying to fly down, which is paid in taking fewer time off, and that works its way through other employees who benefit because they're not having to cover somebody who's missing. Just want to be clear about this question of fully rolling out compliance that's touched on the report. I was a member of the audit committee at the time when we did have that report about managers not complying, not filling things in. And so I can see that we've moved on. I want to be sure that the program is fully rolled out. It's just talked about in paragraph 4.7 of when fully rolled out. And the various dates in the report and appendices are pretty clear that where there is a program for managers to use, that they are using it.
Yeah, okay. That refers to the training I'm doing, and also some of the new reports that we have developed. So the training is in progress. I think we're 40, 50 manager sessions in. And that was largely about growing up back to basics with managers. It's actually desktop-based training, so we're sitting with them, making sure they're clear about reporting requirements and what their obligations are in terms of first day referrals, in terms of back to work interviews, keeping in touch with employees and offset. So that's a HR team we're rolling that out at the moment. Because one or two issues we picked up from the audit report actually were training issues in terms of particularly where we've got a reasonable turnover staff back in children's services. So yes, when it's fully rolled out, obviously that would be in a better position to measure compliance and address any issues. We feel it's falling short of what standards and expectations are.
So just so you come back to when is fully rolled out completed?
For that, May. Yeah, for that particular training, yeah.
Okay, anybody else? Okay, so we're being asked to note the data analysis in the report. One additional recommendation, I think it would be useful to have a further update on this, maybe in those 6 months,
yeah.
Just to see how things have moved on and a lot of these programmes have been in place. So can we add that as an additional recommendation?
Yeah.
Is that okay? Can we agree that? Yeah, is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay.
Just as a comment on that, Chair, each scrutiny committee gets a regular report on absence management in the department of their scrutinising, don't they? And they usually does trigger, certainly adults and children, it usually does trigger quite a lot of questions and discussion around. So in some ways this is slightly duplicating what's going on in the context.
Okay, but I mean, I think it'd be useful for us to have a kind of round-robin report that brings all the data together from all the service accounts. Okay, so can we agree that? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Good. Thank you. Right, so that takes us to, thanks, Tony, takes us to item number 5, which is the resolution, the exemption resolution. To members of the public. I'm going to move that we agree that recommendation. Is that seconded?
Agreed.
Is that approved? Okay, thank you very much. Can I ask the members of the public